Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's service at Beaumaris-Mordialloc Baptist Church. And if this is your first time joining us, I just want to extend a special welcome to you, and of course, welcome to everyone joining us online as well. My name's Andy, and I'll be helping to lead this morning's service. I'd like to just start by reading Psalm 150 as we prepare our hearts for worship this morning. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Praise him with the timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And today, David will be speaking on We Care for All People. Out of this series, The God Life, a life that glorifies God from the book of John. And as part of that, our focus question this morning will be, what helps you feel cared for? And of course, for those joining online, they can discuss that topic in the chat. Please join me as we open in prayer as well. Lord, as we prepare our hearts for worship, help us call to mind your mighty acts of power and surpassing greatness. Truly, there is none like you. Please bless our service today and work in and through us as we worship and glorify you this morning. Amen.
Holy, 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 see you. Holy, 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 I want to see you.
Please join in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your presence in our lives, in our world, and indeed throughout history. You are faithful, and we can depend completely on your continued faithfulness. Yet we have not been equally faithful at all times. We each fall short of your perfect standard and need your mercy and grace. It is in recognition of this that we pray in the words of David from Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, so that sinners will turn back to you. Open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart you, God, will not despise. And Father, we also lift up to you the various needs of our church body this morning. We pray for those facing significant health challenges that you would provide for their needs and fill them with your hope and peace. We pray specifically for Betty, who is at the end of her chemo and radiotherapy treatment. We pray for the effectiveness of that treatment. We pray for Shirley's surgery that would be effective and that you would help her to recover quickly. We pray for Peter A. for his vision. And we pray for our pastors, church staff, and leaders that you would encourage and lead them, fill them with your grace and wisdom, and protect them from the evil one. We pray for our outreach partners and the kingdom work that they are involved in, the Jennings, Andersons, the Widows Project, Noble Park, Karen Baptist, and the work of sports chaplaincy in Nates. Lord, we ask that you would continue to provide for, guide, and ultimately help these ministries to be fruitful. We also pray for the work at BASIS. We pray for the work that it does in our local area with those who are vulnerable and in need of support. And we also pray for the ways that we as a church seek to partner with them. And Father, we pray for those in leadership roles in the various levels of government in our city, state, and country. We pray that you would grant them wisdom, a heart of compassion and care, and that you would protect them from evil. And we also continue to pray for the ongoing efforts being made to manage the spread and impact of the coronavirus in Australia and around the world, that they would be effective. And Lord, we also lift up to you the conflict in Israel, and we just pray, Lord, for a resolution and for peace there. And Father, as David speaks this morning, I pray that you'd guide him and open our minds and hearts to receive your words through him. This we ask in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We'll also move into today's Bible reading now, which comes from John chapter 17, verses 6 through 17. Jesus prays for his disciples. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, you gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine, and glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by that name you gave me. None has been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that Scripture would be fulfilled. I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth.
Welcome, everybody, this morning. I add to Andy's welcome, whether you're here with us in person or whether you're watching online. A special welcome if you're joining with us for the first time or if you're relatively new in connecting in with us. We are a community of people who seek to find and follow Jesus together. And we seek to be intergenerational across the ages, not just one age group, but across all ages as a church family. And some of the ways that help us in that I encourage you to be a part of are firstly a small group. And in over these weeks at the moment through the rest of May, we're focusing on our core values as a church, and the small groups will be looking at how they can live those core values out. And so I want to encourage you, if you're not a part of a small group, to consider being a part of one. And even just have a taster over these weeks ahead. And I'll be in the developing next steps and welcoming area that's gradually taking shape out in the foyer. If you're on site, if you're online, you can connect in through the email on our website. So I encourage you to be a part of a small group. It's a great way of sharing in community with others and growing in finding and following Jesus together. If you're on site, we also encourage you to connect after our service over our COVID-safe adapted morning tea. Barista Coffee last week was on the house for Mother's Day and the relaunch of it. It's not on the house every week, so I can't give you that offer every week, but we encourage a $3 donation. All the profits go towards outreach. And there are bulk coffee cards available. But if you'd rather just have regular tea and coffee, then you can be hosted in that again this morning. Online, again, through live chat is a way of connecting. We can't connect over coffee online, but you can connect through chat or through the website. And the other area that we encourage everybody in is to, like we looked at last week, be a contributor, not just a consumer. And that's one of our core values. And there are many and varied ways that you can contribute or serve in and across church life and beyond. And again, if you're on site in that developing, welcoming and next steps area, in that zone, there's a little ministry area display, and speak with myself or one of the pastoral or ministry team members there afterwards. Speaking of ministry, thank you for your ongoing support of the life and the ministry and the outreach of Beaumaris-Mordialloc Baptist Church through online giving. Let's just pause and pray and acknowledge that we have a part to play in God's work, and what a wonderful privilege that is. God, we thank you for your work. Your work is amazing. Your work is wonderful. We think of your creative work, but we think of your sustaining work, and we think of your providing work. And God, you have blessed us in multiple ways, in many ways. We must not forget to give thanks, and we must remember not to take things for granted. We want to thank you that we can play a part in your work through giving. through our time, through our talents, through the through different ways that we can play a part in your work. And so through our, as we think of our gifts and offerings, we pray that they would be used wisely and well to make a difference in the lives of people. Used wisely and well to help people find and follow Jesus. So God, as we think of your work, we also think of your word, as we come to that in a moment now, that time in our service where we hear from you, where we look at your word, the central part of our service. And so we pray, God, that you would help us to be attentive to what it is that you have to say to each of us individually today, as well as to us together. And we pray this in and through the name of Jesus, the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Well, as we continue our series in John, the God life, a life that glorifies God. One of the things that, one of the places that I love to go, and it's going to sound really strange, but I love to go to our local bank. Now, I know, a bank is not typically the kind of place that people like to go to. Most of us, myself included, actually do most of our banking online. I do very little banking in person these days, but nevertheless, I love going to this particular branch of a bank that shall remain nameless publicly. Now, why am I doing that? It's because it wouldn't be right of me to be seen to be promoting one bank above another, but feel free to ask me which bank and where privately though, and I'd be happy to share more with you. But why do I love going there? Even though I don't go there all that often, because it's a different experience to any other branch of a bank that I've been to. The tellers take the time to chat to you, and they even care for people. You're not just a number. You're not just someone to dispense money to or speak with about financial matters. It's a place, an unlikely place perhaps, where relationships matter, where people are cared for. And I began to ask myself the question, mind you, I did do a few transactions there with, that were to their benefit and not just for mine. but I began to ask myself the question, what has led to this particular bank branch being the way that it is that makes it stand out to me? And the answer was not only the core values that were terrific that were displayed on the wall, but it was the way that their actions showed that they lived those out. It was the way that their actions were different to other banks that I'd been to that showed, to me at least, in my experience, that they cared for all people. Last week, we began to remind ourselves of what our core values are, not as a bank, but as a church. And as a church is even more significant in God's purposes than a bank or any other human institution. A church is God's institution. It's God's people. It's the family of God. It's the place that the purposes of God for all of humanity, above all, should be understood and lived out. And we began with the first value of being a contributor, not a consumer. Great values are important because they shape and they drive who we are and what we're about. And Jesus's values are the greatest ones of all for us to base our lives around. And today we come to our second core value as a church, which is we care for all people. We care for all people. It's a big statement. And yet it's one that, by the grace of God, we seek to embrace and we seek to live out. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Say that again. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And Jesus, more than anyone who has ever lived, modelled a life of that for all people. He modelled a life of care to anyone and everyone. He modelled a life of care to his closest followers, his disciples. But he modelled a life of care to those beyond that as well. And how do our actions show that we care for all people, though? It's by us as a church being a safe place. It's by us being a place where relationships matter, where people are important, where people are valued. And in the part of John chapter 17 that we come to today, as you know, those of you who've been journeying with us, you know that we've been working our way through different parts of John, and we're into chapter 17 and looking over these weeks when we look at our core values, at how they link in with Jesus' words in John 17 and Jesus' prayer. But that today, in the verses that Andy read to us, it's clear from Jesus' words that we care for people by doing three significant things as he did. And the three things, to make it memorable for you, I'll call looking into, looking up, and looking out. Looking into, looking up, and looking out. How do we show we care? By looking into, by looking up, and looking out. Number one, we show we care for people when we look into each other's eyes. Now, when I say look into each other's eyes, I'm not meaning a staring competition. One of my daughters plays these staring competitions every now and then with me, and I always bomb out. We have to look at each other until one of us blinks, and she gets me every time. I'm blinking before she's blinking. But that's not what I'm meaning when I say look into each other's eyes, and I'm not meaning a strange look, but I'm speaking of a look that looks out for other people, a look of authenticity that takes the time to care, to say not just how are you, but how are you really? Not just how are you, but how are you really? When we greet one another, we say how are you, when we say good, and we reciprocate that. But there's not always time to go beyond that. But it's important to not just say how are you, but how are you really? A book that had a real impact on me some years ago was a book called Leading with a Limp. And it's not just in leading that we can be limping. It's simply in living too. We can be living with a limp, all of us. Living with limps of different sorts and in different ways. Living with very real challenges. Living with very real concerns. Living with things that we do our best to cope with but that aren't easy. Life is messy. But what does Jesus speak of here in verses 6 to 8? He says this, "I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given them comes from me. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me." Jesus disclosed things. He's describing a relationship here where he has revealed himself honestly, authentically, vulnerably with others, in this case, his disciples. And we are called to be a safe and secure place for people. We are called to be a church community who ask people, how are you really? People who value authenticity and vulnerability. People who allow space, not just for the sharing of life's highs and life's hopes, which are wonderful, but who allow space equally for the sharing of life's heartaches and life's hurts. Romans chapter 15 says this, Paul says in Romans chapter 15, verse 7, "Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God." Accept one another, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. He doesn't say accept one another when you've got it all together. He doesn't say accept one another when everything's just as it should be. No, he just says accept one another, just as Christ accepted you, with the grace of God, with the grace of Christ, with a care for people wherever they're at and whatever their situation. We show we care for people, firstly, when we look into each other's eyes with the care of Jesus. But secondly, when we look up with each other's hands in prayer to Jesus. As we read on here in John chapter 17 into verses 9 and 10, we read this, Jesus saying, "I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine, and glory has come to me through them." And what Jesus is saying here, what we discover is that his care for people through prayer is very evident. He wasn't just talking with them. He wasn't just coming alongside them. He was lifting people up before his heavenly Father in prayer. I recently was lifting a piece of furniture from one room to another at home, and it was a real struggle on my own. My arms began to sag, but when someone else came alongside me and someone else's hands helped in that, what a difference that made. When our hands come along someone else in prayer, and when we lift them up before our God who is able to do over and above what any of us can, what a difference that can make too. When someone is struggling, when someone begins to sag and lag in what they may be facing in life and faith. There's a remarkable account in the Bible, right back in the book of Exodus, Exodus chapter 17, about Moses. And Moses' hands were reaching up to God in prayer in the midst of the battle that God's people faced literally against a group of people called the Amalekites. And it's in Exodus chapter 17. And I'll just read a snapshot of that from Exodus chapter 17, verse 10 through to 12. So Joshua fought the Amalekites, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went to the top of the hill. As long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. And that's remarkable. But then into verse 12, when Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held his hands up, one on one side, one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till sunset. What an amazing picture. Moses' hands grew weary, but someone came on one side and someone else came on the other side to hold up his hands. And what's remarkable here is not just the way that Moses was praying, but the way that Aaron and Hur came alongside him in prayer. They held up his hands when he grew weary. They kept him steady. Praying for each other, praying for others, is such an important way of caring for others. It holds them up before God when they need it most. I wonder, how and when are you caring for others through prayer? Praying for someone is not simply a cliche. It's easy to say, I'll pray for you. It's easier to say, well, yeah, I know about prayer. But how and when are you caring for others through prayer? It's not simply a cliche. It's the critical part of the critical care process. I'll say that again. It's the critical part of the critical care process. Because what does it do? It involves lifting someone up before our Creator, before our Sustainer, before our Redeemer, our Restorer, our Healer, our life-changing God. How do we care for people? We seek to care for people by looking into each other's eyes. We seek to care for people by looking up with each other's hands. And thirdly, we seek to care for people by looking out for each other's backs. I spoke a few moments ago about lifting up some furniture. And when you lift up furniture, you have to be careful, when you lift up anything heavy, actually, you have to be careful to lift it properly so as to do what? So as to look after your back. And I haven't had a heap of back issues to this point in my life, but I have noticed that there's starting to be a few back issues there. A sign of just, time marching along, and some of you know all about that. But Jesus calls us to not just look out for our backs. Jesus calls us to look out for each other's backs, or to have each other's backs. Into verse 11 and 12 and 15 and 17, what does he say here? He says, I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them, and I kept them safe by that name you gave me. None has been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that the scripture would be fulfilled. And then if we go across to verse 15, he reiterates this theme again. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you, what? Protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. And Jesus here is making it clear about the need for his followers to be, what? Be protected. He's making it clear that he has our backs spiritually. But what do we need to be protected from? And that's clear too. It's not from suffering, even. It's not from pain. It's not from the things that that we might think. But above all, we need to be protected from Satan's attempts to distract us, to derail us, to discourage us, or to divide us as God's people. And 1 Peter chapter 5 says this. It reminds us, it says, "Humble yourselves then under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you." But then it's followed up with these words, "Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings." We need to make sure that we are caring for one another spiritually, not just physically or practically. We need to make sure that we are living out what it means to be God's people and that we have each other's backs. How do we do that? By preserving the unity of God's church, by making sure that we speak with someone before we speak about them, by not allowing a sense, and COVID has brought a great sense of disconnection and a great sense of disruption to life in general, but it's also brought a great sense of disconnection and disruption to the community of God's people, whether that's here or anywhere. And we need to be careful to make sure that that we don't allow that to either fragment God's church or to cause us to forget what church community life really is all about, which is gathering together, which is watching, which is caring for each other, which is watching out for one another's back spiritually. Now is a time to watch out, not opt out. It's a time to be alert, not ambivalent spiritually. It's a time to show more than show that we value one another, and we value the core value of caring well for one another by living out what the writer of Hebrews tells us to do in Hebrews chapter 10, where we read from verse 23 onwards. The writer of Hebrews says, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." Look into each other's eyes. Look up with each other's hands. Look out for each other's backs. Not just to care for people, but ultimately to glorify God, which is what our series from John points us to above all, to live a life, a God life, a life that glorifies God, to be a people who stand out because relationships matter amongst us, because we create safe places for people as we live out by the grace of God, caring for all people, not just in our words, but in our actions. Let me pray as we continue to look to and learn from God in how to keep growing in this together. Let's pray. God, we thank you for being able to be a part of the community of your people and all that that means. But we thank you for your care and all that that means. Thank you that care for people is close to your heart. And Jesus, as you came to earth and lived on this earth, you modeled that. You showed that. And you show us how to live that out. It was a value that you lived out as well as expressed in your words. Help us to also be characterized by this, to grow in care for others, to show increasingly care for others, in care that looks into each other's eyes, that values sharing life's challenges together, that takes time for people, that is attentive people's situations. It doesn't just brush by or rush by, but values people and seeks to really be a safe place of authenticity, of vulnerability, of growing in sharing life and faith together. Help us to grow and show a care that looks up with each other's, looks up with each other's hand in prayer, valuing holding up others, recognizing that we all need that in our lives. We all need others who hold us up before you in prayer. But we all have a part to play in that with others, and that's a part of our care for people. God, you again, as we look at the life of Jesus and the way he modeled this, help us to be able to build this into our lives as we follow Jesus. And also a care that values others and the community of God's people, values protecting one another. Again, God, how important it was to you that the community, not just any community, but the community of God's people, your church, and how precious and special that is to you. And so the part that we have to play in looking out for each other's back spiritually, in making sure that we do whatever we can to express care for others and care for your church in that way. Help us, Lord God, to spur one another on, to encourage one another in these things, not just for our benefit, not just for one another's benefit, even though that is important and wonderful, but ultimately for your glory, God, to fulfill your purposes for us. And so we ask for your grace in this. We ask for your ongoing sense of shaping us and making us to be more and more the people that you've called us to be. Help us to come back to the core values that you have given us, and to seek to not only know those, but seek to show those in who we are and what we're about. And we ask this in and through the all-powerful, all-gracious, all-loving, all-caring name of Jesus, our Saviour and our God. Amen.
My hope is found.
Well, thank you everyone for joining us this morning, and I hope you found today's service encouraging and have, through David's message, thought of some new ways or some good reminders about how we can care for those people in our lives. Also, if you do require prayer this morning, or would like prayer this morning, there'll be a member of the prayer team down in the front. Or for those joining online, feel free to reach out to one of the pastors whose contact information is available on the church's website. And let me just close now with a benediction from Jude. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, and power and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace and have a blessed week.